Good evening, everyone. Welcome. Good to see you all here. My name is Piers Handling, Director and CEO of TIFF. I hope you're all having a wonderful festival. This is the North American premiere of Adina Pintilie's Touch Me Not. I'd like to start out by acknowledging that tonight's event is taking place on the treaty territory of the Mississaugas of New Credit and the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and the Anishinaabe and the Huron-Wendat. We're very grateful to have the opportunity to work in the community. I'd like to also mention this film is eligible for the Gorlsch People's Choice Award, so please vote at tiff.net/vote. I'd also like to thank the people that brought us this evening's film, Kino Lorber and Doc and Film International. Now, this is Adina's first dramatic feature film after having made a number of documentaries. It went on to win, surprisingly, maybe not surprising, it's a superb film, but for a first-time filmmaker, the Golden Bear at the recent Berlin Film Festival. That's the top prize, the best film. And for those of us who feel that cinema should confront as opposed to reassuring, this is a film that absolutely does that. It forces us to confront all kinds of prejudices, I found, and attitudes, and it can make us feel uncomfortable at times. And then it opens new doors in a very surprising way and forces us into new responses. This is a very intriguing film, which is why I think it won such a prestigious prize in Berlin. Please join me in welcoming the director of the film, Adina Pintilie.
Thank you. Thank you, Pierce. Thank you, Toronto Film Festival, for inviting us. It's a very important moment, actually, because it's the North American premiere of the film. And I'm not going to say too much now. I'm going to be here for the Q&A. And I have also one more colleague from my team, the composer of the film, here, in case you will have questions. I would just like to say that, you know, this film started, it's born out of a long-term research, where I had the chance to work with a group of people which are extremely gifted, and they have a huge, they had and they still have a huge courage to share with us really special areas of their intimate life. And from the very beginning, these people wanted to have a dialogue with you, the viewer. So I invite you to take this invitation, to accept this invitation to dialogue and to stay with us until the end and continue this dialogue. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Dorota Lech and it is my honor to call back to the stage Adina Pintilie.
Thanks. Thanks for staying with us to the end.
Adina, first, I just want to start by saying personally, thank you so much for this film. It means a lot to me on a personal level. And full disclosure, Adina and I know each other quite well, and we've spent some time talking about this film. And I just really wanted to start by putting myself out there and telling you that really watching this the second time reminded me how I felt the first time, and I was completely shattered afterwards. And it really did change my life and make me think about things that I haven't thought about in a long time. And I just want to say thank you. So.
Good to hear. Thanks. Thanks a lot. It's important to hear this.
And feedback. I know that people should kind of take a moment to think about their own feelings before asking questions. So you'll have a moment to think about your feelings. And I'll start by asking Adina another personal question. Can you talked a little bit in the beginning about the research that took to make this film, but can you talk about how you personally prepared to expose yourself like this on screen?
Well, I didn't. It just came on the process, you know, it was like unavoidable in the end. It's quite a long story. I mean, the process started years ago, like when, I'm also seeing it in the film, when I was 20, I thought I knew how things go with intimacy, like what beauty is, how relationships should function and all this kind of stuff. And after many years of real life, I realized basically I don't know much. All these ideas really, really got blurry. And the project started from this intention to forget everything I thought I knew about intimacy, about, you know, how people relate to each other. What I knew from family, from education, from, you know, all these ideas which are inoculated in your system, and try to rediscover, to relearn, basically, how people relate for real, how people really experience this this aspect of their lives, which is of our lives, which is often so difficult and it's so full of contradictions. Whereas our ideal projection, it's very far away from reality. So I started by searching my collaborators, which was a key part of the process. And together we started a sort of a personal research. For me, it was very important. Like, I worked with a mix of actors, let's say, or professional actors and non-professionals, but it's not important in my perspective whether they are professionals or not. I worked with them as human beings. We all were human beings there, which brought a mix of personal material and staged, fictionalized elements. And in all this process, fiction functioned more like a sort of safety net, which allowed us, it was like a space, it created a space which brought us together, a safe space, where we could explore areas which otherwise would have been very difficult to explore in a normal documentary or in a classical documentary or classical fiction, because in a fiction you are so much imprisoned by the character that is written for you, whereas in documentary you kind of feel obliged to be what you usually are or what you use the people that you are. And in this space we could really project things. We could explore areas of ourselves which we wouldn't, like, for example, Laura was saying beautifully at one point that she really went places where she wouldn't have dared in a normal situation. We worked with the reenacted memories, with the dreams, with fears, like projections of really tough situations, possible situations. So what can I say? And to come back to your first question, is I think it's very important that when I search for these people, I was searching for people on the same, it was not a regular casting, I was searching for people on the same wavelength, let's say, that had the same interest in exploring this aspect. And what was very important for me is that they had a strong motivation to share this research, because it was not only a research that we would do, but it was also the aspect of sharing it, to live your life in the presence of the camera, in the presence of a film crew, and to share this with the audience, because the film was basically built like this from the very beginning. It was built like a sort of a dialogue. As you see, like, you follow the experiences of the protagonists, and then from time to time they start to talk to you and they share with you. They share their experiences. My presence in the film and the presence of the camera was not intended in the beginning. It was the dialogue and the fourth wall fluidity, it was intended. This is why we had to use that device that you see in the film, which is called teleprompter, which is used like in television for so many years, and Errol Morris used it in documentary. And this device would allow the protagonist to enter into a dialogue directly with the viewer. So to look in the lens directly, because it's a very strong emotional, it's very different, actually, emotional effect if you enter into a dialogue with someone next to the lens, or if you discuss directly with the lens. It was very important for the film because the film was a dialogue with the viewer. And when I put together the material, I realized these moments when the protagonist would talk to the audience didn't function at all as I intended. Like, I intended them as a sort of an emotional connection. But they were disturbing, so they were having the opposite effect, a sort of like a Brechtian distancing effect, because, you know, they took you out from the emotional flow. And I, you know, it took me a lot of time to really understand what's going on, and the editing was quite long. And I realized that actually we have the way we read cinema, it's so imprinted in our brains that whenever we go to cinema, we kind of enter, you know, we separate from our body and we enter into that experience like on the screen, into that bubble of story. Either, it doesn't matter if it's fiction, non-fiction, or any other like label we could put on the experience. So it's separated. And for us, it was very important to try to have this permanent emotional connection between the body of the viewer and the body of the film. So this is why it became organically necessary to introduce the camera, the apparatus. So you know that basically that camera, it's a sort of a channel. You know what you look at. It's the camera which is a channel, a communication bridge, which is offering you a really, let's say, privileged access to this very like intimate life of these people who are like sharing that with you. They are entering into a dialogue with you. And then the next stage, the next, let's say, disappointment or crisis in terms of structure and the way we share this in language, because the language was quite, finding the language was quite a language challenge in this process, was the fact that if you only have the device, if you only have the camera, the apparatus, the meta cinema at just the formal level, and you don't know what's motivating that presence, you don't know the emotional results of the presence of the camera there, it doesn't work, because there is that aspect of like, you know, I couldn't be in a different position than the protagonist. In reality, in the whole process, I was there, I was sharing with them the experiences, I was sharing them their stories, but if in the film I wouldn't introduce this process, there is this sort of distance where the filmmaker seems like a sort of a, you know, like a sort of a scientist in a laboratory who's observing it with a distance, and that was not the case. So it became emotionally very necessary to also introduce my process there. So you also have a bit of my emotional motivation that started all this research. But I'm not the priority. The filmmaker and the camera is not, in my opinion, is not the priority. So it's what is very important is like, I mean, I'm feeling like a sort of a, like a child, you know, which is discovering the world. Like it's learning, you know, from Hannah, from Christian, from all of them. I'm living together with them and I'm learning, you know, things. They are really, I had quite a privilege to work with such a group of amazing people. Yeah.
Thank you for your very thoughtful answer. That
okay.
was incredible.
No, was quite long.
I want to be like inside your brain. You have the opportunity to ask Adina a question. I will repeat it so everyone can hear. Can you raise your hands up high and wave them? It's really hard to see. Otherwise, I will keep talking. Is everyone just in complete shock
it's
at how Adina's brain works?
It's somebody there. And I have to tell you also that we have here in the room a very important member of our team, the composer. It's Ivo there. So if you also have questions regarding the musical concept and this part of the film.
Beautiful work, Ivo. Yes, there was a hand. Yes.
Oh, that was the only way. Oh,
the question was, can you talk about your decision to set the film in English?
Yeah, got it. So that was unavoidable, you know, because this is a co-production between Romania, Bulgaria, Germany, France, Czech Republic, with support from Eurimage, with the cast coming from like France, UK, Australia, Bulgaria, Germany, Iceland, Romania. So I hope I didn't skip any country, but it wouldn't matter anyway. So this was our only language. And actually, it's conceptually, this place that you see in the film, it's not geographically, it's very important, it's not geographically defined. So it's a, let's say, Western city, somewhere in Europe, it can be also in US. It's a borderless space, where people from different backgrounds, because you feel we kept the exact like accents, the native accents. I mean, this is my accent, a very Russian accent. So it's the way we speak English. It's exactly this kind of life that we recently have. My generation has this kind of like nomadic life. We have this community which crosses borders ever since the European Union exists. and we speak all this broken English, full of errors. So I hope you could bear with us. So
it's great.
Yeah, it's important to understand each other, I think. And the film is dealing with an area which I think it's generally human. It's this area, like, we all have a body, we all have a sexual life, we all do our best to experience our intimacy, but this is a subject so much surrounded by taboos and by conflicting emotions, and we find it so difficult to talk about. So yeah, that's the borders, I guess. It's a borderless film in many respects, if we are to play with words. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, in the back. Yes. The question is, you end the film with what seems to be a conversation with your mother about breaking the umbilical cord. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
There was more.
And the second part of, there was a second question about the dance at the end.
But I think I'm missing something. I think you said something about the whole conversation with the mother, how does it fit with the whole film?
Yeah.
Wow. thank you for the question. It's, I think the film would speak for itself, in my opinion. What we discovered in all this research, let's say, is the way our initial connection with our parents, and in particular with the mother, with the body of the mother, it's influencing, it's impacting our later relationships as adults, including in intimacy. And, you know, as it goes in the film, at one point, like, tell me how you are loved, so I can tell you how you love. There is one of the books that, there were several books, like research books written by two psychoanalysts that were very important in our research. One of them was called Arousal by the American psychoanalyst Michael Bader, and the other one was called Mating in Captivity, Reconciling the Domestic and the Erotic by Esther Perel. It's quite a wonderful title. And these books are actually discussing about how these early relationships are impacting, very often in an unconscious way, our present relationship. And how the more we get close to each other, because desire, attraction, it's so easy in the beginning when we don't know each other. But the more we know each other, the more difficult intimacy becomes, because the dynamics that we learned in childhood come into play. And Bader was joking at one point, saying that the time passes, the more people you have in your bedroom as a couple. So because you have her mother, his mother, grandparents, and all kinds of family. So actually, that's a sort of front cover and end cover of the film, because also in the beginning I'm talking with the mother, but in the beginning it's an ambiguity is left, that I could talk basically. The way you relate to your mother, it's influencing the way you relate with the significant other. So in the beginning, it could have been a lover, it could have been a brother, a father, any emotionally significant other. So I wanted to keep the ambiguity of the person in the beginning. So, I hope I answered, but I could go on that.
It's definitely been my experience with Adina that when you get into a conversation with her, you don't want it to end. Unfortunately, our Q&As are only 20 minutes. Well, we will be outside a little bit further past the hall. Hopefully we can take a few more.
Also.
And there are two more screenings. Please tell your friends, your family, your loved ones, your enemies to go see this film.
It's a film to see with your mothers in particular, so...
Thank you so much for being here. Congratulations.
Welcome, so it's gone.
Okay. He's telling us to get off the stage.